Welcome to the Fran Snyder Podcast, where I talk to artists and music fans to explore how music connects us through great stories and experiences. Brought to you by the Listening Room Network. Today's guest, RayCerbone. How are you today?
Good, Fran. How you doing?
Good, good. Great to connect with you. We're introduced through the Americana Community Music Association, not to be known by their initials, which is always what wants to come out of my mouth. Anyway, it's great to connect with you. I've been hearing about you around Florida for quite some time. Mm-hmm. I really want to sort of dig in that, you know, sort of your background, how you wound up in Florida. And so let's start with where you're from. Tell us about the early days and when you started playing music.
All righty. Well, I'm from Lake Placid, Florida, via Bronx, New York.
So, where is Lake Placid? Because I think Lake Placid, New York. Where's Lake Placid, Florida?
We're just south of Sebring, right in central Florida, where all the lakes are.
Oh, okay.
You know, beautiful, beautiful location. In fact, we lucked out here and found a nice spot. Guy was just looking to get out of this house. He was flipping it, and he kept putting money. And his wife finally said, "Sell it."
Yeah.
And we were standing in the doorway when she did. And luckily we got as a little lake right outside. So we're blessed.
How far are you from Fort Myers then? Is that the closest big city or?
No. We're centrally located here. So within an hour and a half, you're an hour and a half, hour and 45, you're down in Fort Myers, Cape Coral. You're in the center of Florida, just north of Lake Okeechobee. So the East Coast or the West Coast, it's only about an hour and a half to 2 hour ride, and bam, you're on major water, either on the Gulf or the ocean.
So from there you can hit southeast Florida, Miami, Fort Lauderdale, all those
right.
places,
or,
all the way to
Tampa, Tampa, Sarasota, St. Pete.
Excellent.
It's all just a zippity doo-dah ride, and we're there.
Great.
That's why we like it here. We have quiet, we have serenity, etc. Can write. Music scene's kind of, you know, it's got a little ways to go. We got here and I was looking for the Americana scene and it wasn't here.
All right. So
we're trying to bring it in.
All right. So let's backtrack to New York, the Bronx. I have friends that are from there. It's where the old Yankee Stadium was, right?
Yes. And when I say Bronx, well, that's where I was born and only lived there until about fourth or fifth grade. And then we moved to WestChester, which is just about 35 miles north of where we were, a little gentler, a little kinder.
Yeah.
And I grew up there, actually lived there my whole adult life, lived there, went to school there, worked there. And when I retired, that's when I left. And down in Florida, I came about, 9, 10 years ago now.
Okay. And so where were you when you started music and, you know, what was the scene? Were you going to New York City to play or were you mostly?
Yeah, we could start right back at the beginning. In fact, I've got a song about that called Steel on Wood.
Yeah, that's great. That's the album title as well, right?
No, the album title is How Much Time.
Oh, okay.
Right. But that's the opening track. And it's kind of that song's great. It gives you the background on how I got my first guitar, et cetera. And I'm going to tell that little story now.
Sure.
So I got in the music scene probably, I was about 14 or 15 years old, hooked up with a fellow named Ralph. I won't say his last name. keep the innocent innocent. Ralph was a student at the School of Visual Arts in Manhattan. He was an art student. And I used to go to his house and we did what art students do back in the 60s.
I love it.
And we had a good time. And he had a little, what he called a Spanish guitar, nylon string guitar, a Spanish guitar sitting in the corner. I used to pick it up, play some notes. And he wasn't much of a player. He knew a couple of songs that he took all the verses and made them into one. But I got an interest and I kept saying to him, Ralph, I want to get a guitar. And he says, well, you know where we got to go? We got to get downtown. We got to get down to Music Row, where Manny's and the first Sam Ash and all of that were. It was a section of New York City that was music stores. The big names, all the stars would go down there. when they were in New York and go in these music stores, and you could run into just about anybody. Jimi Hendrix or any of the folkies were in there all the time. So one day we took his car down a train station, jumped on a train, and I had $15 in my pocket for a guitar. Now, today we would say, yeah, you can just about buy a set of D'Addario strings. So we got down there and took the train to Manhattan and the subway, and we got here and we went into all those music stores. And I played some wonderful, well, played at the time. The C chord was the challenge. So I played my C chord in those stores on some amazing guitars and realized that was not going to happen. I couldn't afford any of that. So we continued up the street till we came to the pawn shops. That's where it was going to happen.
Yeah.
And I got in there and an old guy comes out and, can I help you? And yeah, I'm looking for a guitar. How much you got? So I got $15. He goes, well, I might have something for you. And he comes out with this cardboard case. And you probably know those cardboard cases, no protection for the guitar. He opens that thing and here is this guitar, nylon string guitar, where someone had hit it with a ball peen hammer in the top. So there was an additional little hole in there. And he said, I'll give you that one for $10 with the case. And I said, you got it. Handed my money. And he said, well, wish you a lot of luck, son. And out I went. And we took the train ride home and I'm holding onto this thing like it's a golden Martin. And we got home and that was my very first guitar with the action about that high off the neck.
Oh my goodness. That's fun.
Yeah. Oh, it was a panic, but I learned my first Donovan song on that guitar. And in fact, I forget where I looked it up. There was no internet back then. There was no internet lessons. I bought a book. That's what I did. I bought the Mel Bay Learn to Play Your Guitar book, the chord book. Yeah, you know.
Oh, yeah.
That was old school. You didn't get on there and they show you how to play Thunderstruck. You know, we didn't have any of that. We had a book and the hand, the picture, the photograph of the hand.
Oh, man.
So you made your hand look like his hand.
That really takes me back, yeah.
Yeah, right? And I learned some Donovan songs with a Donovan song book. And in fact, the one was a song called To Sing For You by Donovan. And that was the song Ralph used to play. And as I'm looking at the words, I'm realizing he took a line from each verse and made one verse. And that's all he used to sing over and over. That and Talking Candy Bar Blues, which that's another one goes way back. So I learned the song with the correct words. And I went over there one day and, Ralph, you know, you taught me that song all wrong. And then I played it for him. He goes, well, just remember when you become famous, who taught you to play the guitar?
Nice.
So every once in a while, we're together and he lives in upstate New York and he'll have friends over and I'll play and they'll go, wow, that's pretty good stuff. And Ralph will go, yeah, I taught him everything he knows. That was our trip downtown to buy that first guitar. And that's when I got started.
Nice. So if I'd have been that store owner, I'd have taken your $15.
Well, that guitar was rough. I did go back now. There's a little addendum. I went back and I went to, and I'm not going to remember if it was Manny's or the other store down there, but I went into one of the high-end stores and then I had a couple of bucks.
Yeah.
And I bought my first real guitar, which was a Fender Kingman steel string guitar with a real case, a real guitar. And I bought that in one of those stores and it was a proud moment. What's sad now is, it's gone. All the, not just the guitar, but all the stores. Hmm. Music Row is history.
Yeah. A lot of people have never heard of Music Row in New York. You always think of Nashville when you hear the words Music Row. Yeah.
It was a place where, like I said, you'd be in there and noodling around on a guitar and suddenly in walks a star. I mean, anyone could walk in at any time and they didn't get molested when they got in there. They walked in there. People would look and go, Jimi Hendrix, you know, and oh my God, and nothing. He'd smile at you. Richie Havens walked in, smiled at me with those no teeth at the time. Funny.
Right. There was no fan entitlement back then. Just like,
Everybody was just another musician and everybody had fun. And we used to play down a village. I'd go down a village with a friend of mine and we go down there and play guitar in a little cafe basement. And this looks like a small space I'm in here. Actually, I've got this up here because my bathroom is being remodeled and all the fixtures from the bathroom behind that screen. But that's this funny. Is my normally my studio and where I record and stuff.
So, all right.
Well, but the space in that cafe basement was there's this little space. We'd go in there and play, and you'd get paid by coffee and Danish. And that was your pay.
Things haven't changed.
No. That's a sad state, but it's true. It's pretty much true.
My dad was in professional baseball, and when he was in the major leagues, his pay was $6,000 a year.
Oh my goodness.
$6,000. This was the early mid 60s. And you know, now like I think the starting salary is like 400,000, 500, which probably half a million now or so. And I was joking around with him one day, telling him that, you know, when I first started playing music in the early 90s, you know, can make a couple hundred bucks for, you know, for a 3-hour happy hour deal. And I said,
yeah,
do you know what that pay is now for a 3-hour happy hour? A couple hundred bucks.
$50. It went down. And right now, right this very minute, there's places here where I've already played for $150, and he's reopened, you know, bringing people in again and doing some live music. And he said, well, I can only pay you $75. I said, for 3 45-minute sets? Well, you can have all the beer you want to drink. I said, yeah, but I don't really drink. I'll have a beer, and that's just not going to make up the difference.
That's why artists have to distinguish themselves as something other than just someone who can play songs for 3 hours. You gotta develop something that's gonna bring people in, as opposed to just entertain the people that are there. So awesome. So what brought you to Florida? Were you visiting when you're and just never left, or was
it's almost true. We, my brother moved down here, and when he first moved down several years ago, he told me, sell your house. It's worth a lot of money up there. Get down here. And my wife at the time, my ex-wife, no, I don't want to move. My family's here. You know the story.
Yeah.
And I said, really? You know, we do much better. No, didn't happen. So I kept visiting down here, and finally that was falling apart up there anyway. And, when the end was happening, I said, well, I'm not staying in New York. There's too much bad here, bad memories. It's fast, it's stressful, and it's expensive. And I'm moving. And I packed up what I could in a U-Haul trailer and towed it on down here and moved down. That was 10 years ago. So I can segue right into how the music thing started down here, if you like.
Yeah, that'd be great. Right, I guess my impression from what you've described so far is that you've been a musician for a long time, but in terms of releasing
1966,
but in terms of releasing albums or CDs, that's kind of a recent thing for you.
Yeah, that was that's why I say I traveled a long road in a short time. When I moved down here, the guitar was, I was on a hiatus from the guitar. I wasn't doing anything, wasn't writing, wasn't playing. And when I moved down here, the guitar kind of sat in a corner and it wasn't doing anything. And I wasn't playing. And I met this wonderful woman online, which was great. I mean, I never would have thought that. Me online? No. That's where you go for other things, but not to meet a serious person. But she was. And she came to the house a couple of times. Then she had gone in and through the bedroom to use the master bath. And there was my guitar in the case sitting in the corner. And she goes, she comes out. She's got a big smile on her face. She goes, oh, you play guitar? And I went, I just stuttered. She goes, well, play something for me. I went, I haven't touched that in months, maybe years. I said, but I promise you, next time you come over, I'll play you a song. So I made sure we didn't have another date for like 2 weeks. I could brush up on your basic GCD special.
If you are enjoying this podcast, can you pause for a moment to like, review, and subscribe? Please help the world discover our music community and the wonderful artists we support. Your feedback makes a difference.
So she came over and I played her something, and she goes, you're really good. You know, I have some friends that play music, and those friends happen to be Roy Schneider and Kim Mayfield.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So she brought over one of his CDs. Now, I had heard all kinds of hokey stuff about singer-songwriters, big egos, right, tough to get along with, show-offs, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, sounds like Roy.
Yeah.
Not at all. Not. If you're listening at home, yeah, and you're not detecting the dripping irony.
Well, that's where I'm going with this. So she handed me the CD and I said, okay, he made a CD. Wonderful. You know, and I put it on and I'm like, well, that's refreshing. And one song drew me, Carriage. I'm sure you're familiar with the song, Carriage. That song is on my CD.
Yeah.
I paid him. We filled out the form and I did it right. Yes. I paid Roy to use his song and one of Jamie Michaels and one of Richard Schindel's. In fact, I did that in person with Richard. That was cool.
That's great.
He accepted a copy of the music and everything. So anyway, she moved in with me eventually and she said, by the way, I'm inviting Roy over to the house. And I went, oh, no, I can't have that. I don't have that skills. Roy turned out to be a wonderful guy. He said, play something. And he watched me play. So then when he played, he didn't do any of that fancy stuff. He kind of came to my level and we started playing stuff together and it was great. I had just a wonderful time, blew my mind completely. So when he was leaving, I took the guitar, I started putting it in a case. He goes, what are you doing? I said, well, I can put the guitar away. He goes, no. He says, you don't put the guitar away. He said, first of all, you're good, better than you think you are. And he goes, you need to leave the guitar out. So every time you walk by, it calls you. And that's a line in my Steel on Wood song too.
That's great.
Sometimes one of them calls to me. And I heard him say that. And I went, yeah, you're right. So I put it in the stand and he was right. Every time I walk by the guitar, hey, psst.
Yeah, that's such a thing, you know, because you know, once you start buying nice guitars, eventually you start reading that, hey, whenever you're not playing, put it in its case, preserve it, make sure that it lasts a long time and it doesn't, the humidity and the dryness don't start to affect the strings. But you know, just like most musicians know, you put the instruments away, you play a lot less because there's no better way to procrastinate the other stuff that you have to do in your life than to pick up that ukulele that's sitting over there. So yeah, that's one of those things. It's just like, you know, okay, you know, put a couple of precious ones away, but you want to make sure you always have some instruments that are in your path. Yeah. You mentioned how gracious Roy was when you guys first jammed together. And there's only a handful of musicians in my music life that have sort of stepped in, like where I was maybe a little intimidated to play with them and, or just maybe a little rusty or just not feeling like I was on top of my game, and they sensed it. And they, instead of showing off, they found the pocket. With the immeasurable amount of skill that they had to do all kinds of fancy stuff, they instead chose to play in a supportive way and actually just really helped me find the groove, really kind of lock in with me. And it's amazing that how you really feel lifted when you play with musicians like that. You just really feel like, it's like, you know, playing tennis with somebody who's a little bit better than you, but they're not destroying you. They're just challenging you, you know, and they're hitting it, making sure that it's not too easy for you, but also they're not trying to put you down.
Correct.
And that's one of the, it's such a joy to find musicians like that who know how to be, you know, because we call them supporting acts, right? A supporting player.
Yeah.
But how many of them are really actually
support? Primary support band. I've been there several
so
times.
So tell me a little bit about the Apocalypse Blues Review.
Yeah, it doesn't roll off the tongue, does it? That's why it was nicknamed ABR. When I got down to Florida here and got involved in music and everything else, I also am an avid motorcyclist. And in the old days, I was actually a biker. There is a distinction. Biker, motorcyclist. It's a lifestyle. Right. It's a hobby.
Got it.
So I've segued out of that because full-time job, careers, et cetera, marriages, child to raise. And I've been riding as long as I've been playing guitar, 1966 till now. I've been all over the country. So
you weren't part of security at Altamont, were you?
No, I missed that one. Called in sick. Called in well. That was a tough one. That was a scary, scary situation. We won't get it. I had some very close friends. I still have motorcycle guys. And I worked in one of the guys' shops. We built a chopper for me at that time too. And he used to play this headbanger music. And I'm a classic rock guy, folky, you know, I like melody and tunes. If it's too loud, yeah, sometimes when you're in the car, you just want, yeah. But, you know, I'm working. I was the front guy. I was on the desk. I was taking orders. My head was exploding. And I used to go back there, what the hell is that? Oh, you don't know who that is. That's my friend playing drums, Shannon Larkin. That's Godsmack. And I went, Godsmack? Okay, do me. So we compromised. Half hour Godsmack, 15 minutes of classic rock, back to Godsmack. Well, when I moved to Florida, he was going to come down here to do some work on my bike and visit for a few days. And he said, when I come down, I'm going to call Shannon and my brother's going to come down. Turned out his brother played in a band with Shannon called the band was Wrathchild America. Another heavy metal band. They were great. So Jay, his brother, shows up and he shows up, Andy, and we end up in a bar in Cape Coral, biker bar. And Shannon comes strolling in. And Shannon is a thin guy. I mean, a thin man. Mm-hmm. And he comes strolling, a big smile and a hat. And first people will look at him, then they realize who he was, the people in the bar. And he came up to us, and here's these gorilla bikers at the time. I was riding a Harley. Mm-hmm. And these guys are monsters. And the little, small, little skinny Shannon comes walking in and he's grabbing everybody, picking them up and hugging them. And it was great. So Shannon and I talked a little bit that day and we were all going out riding the next day. We end up at the Pink Flamingo down in Sanibel. We end up there and we're eating, peel and eat shrimp. There you go. And having a few beers. And Shannon comes on over and sits down next to me. Now I'm not starstruck. I'm not a Godsmack fan. So to me, it's just Shannon Larkin, guy rides a motorcycle, plays drums. Not thinking he's ranked eighth in the world in rock drummers at the time. So we start talking and I was writing stories at the time, short stories, typing up short stories. And he was writing stuff. So he asked me if I wrote and I said, yeah. And he said, well, I'd like to exchange writing with you and check it out. We did. Well, one day my phone rings and Shannon goes, hey man, what are you doing? I said, nothing. You want to go for a ride and go eat? He goes, no. He says, something's come up. Me and Tony Rombolo, the guitar player from Godsmack, have written a blues song and we need somebody to sing it. And me being part of the Americana Community Association and Music Association and having these friends that sing and play, I go, well, hell yeah, man. I know a lot of people that could sing that song for you. He goes, no, we want you to come down and sing it. When he opens the door to the studio, that's when it hit me. They're staring me in the face, are platinum records, gold records, awards. Yeah. This stuff is all over the walls in a pile, stacked up.
Yeah.
There's no more wall space.
Right.
And I'm going, oh, okay. Now it's hitting me. Now I got to audition for a rock star. Mm-hmm. And of course, we know being players ourselves, this happens every day. You get phone calls from rock stars, right? And come on down, sing for me. Yeah, it happens every day.
I usually just don't pick up.
Yeah, right. Let the machine answer it. Like we used to say. So I walk in and he introduces me to Tony, quiet, sitting at the table, very quiet. Pleased to meet you. Very mannerly. So Shannon, yeah, listen to this song, man. And he puts this thing on. I've never heard it. I said, where'd it come from? He goes, we just wrote it. Well, good. This is perfect for me because I know exactly how it goes. And he puts this thing on and it's like heavy blues rock. The name of the song, Hell to Pay. So that should tell you something. It's not Puff the Magic Dragon.
Right.
So I go, I listen to this thing and he's going, yeah. And he's kind of, he doesn't sing well, but he was giving me some scat singing, and I was scat singing, and he hands me the lyric sheet. And he goes, sing it. Hands me a mic. Sing it. And I'm in a little room, and he walks out. So it comes on, and I'm trying to sing this thing, but I'm like, yeah, I'm used to singing Americana. So it's a little different voice going on, you know? And he comes back, and he shuts off. He goes, no. He says, I want you to, like, get down in the gut and really let it out. So he walks back out, turns it on, and I go, well, you know what? It's just two guys in the other room. What have I got to lose? Mm-hmm. So I reared back and I reached down and I just laid it out. And in the middle of it, he sticks his head in the door and he goes, yeah, like that. Yeah. And so that, of course, now that's like, you just hit the turbo boost.
Right.
So now I took it up a notch and I really laid into it. The song ends. And in the other room, I hear, and I went, that's got to be Andy in the other room, his friend and my friend. And this was a joke. So I walk out with a big smile on my face going, yeah, yeah. And it's not. It's Tony Rombola going like this.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, wait a minute, man. This was real. And he looks at, and Shannon looks at me and he goes, how'd you like to be the new lead singer for Blue Cross? It was Blue Cross at the time.
Okay.
The band. And I said,
sure.
Yeah, sure. And I'm going to tell you something. I'd never been in a band in my life.
Yeah.
Never, ever been in a band. We have two records out. We were signed by Mascot, Provog. They signed us. It was great, great day. I got the phone call with Roy Schneider and Jamie Michaels in the room with me.
Nice.
And Shannon called me up and said, we just got signed. And I got off the phone and I went, we just got signed. And Roy just looked at me and goes, oh my God. And Jamie jumped up and grabbed me and hugged me and congratulations.
That's great.
It's like moment.
Yeah.
So we got signed. We did the first record. It did fairly well. We toured. We did the second record and we took it off in a little different direction. And then Godsmack's new record came out, took off, and they had a tour. So we never toured. The band is still there. We want to get together and start playing again when the pandemic lifts. And we're going to keep it small as far as the review goes.
And so in terms of recording, are you working on anything now?
I am personally working on my second record. Roy and Kim have played on a song and sang. I've got an instrumental for the first time, strictly instrumental going on this one with Jake Clayton. He's a Nashville player. He played with Tanya Tucker, toured with her, and Luke Bryan and a lot of other big names. I met him through a thing called Hero Song. So that's coming out well. In fact, and Cat Apple is going to be playing flute on that song. So it's, yeah, some good big names and great people playing on it. I'm very excited about the new record. We're hoping to have that mixed and mastered by the end of the year, and then I can do a release.
Okay, so since we're almost out of time, I want to make sure we cover the Americana Community Music Association. What kind of events have you participated in that they do?
I love the ACMA. And I'll say ACMA. I'm an insider. I can do that. I'm a founding member. I can do that.
There you go.
My wife said to me, there's a group of people I know in the music thing. They want to start this Americana music thing, and they want us to come. So we showed up at the meeting, and we became founding members, my wife and I both. Through the ACMA, my songwriting has flourished, has blossomed, because I was able to get together with other songwriters, exchange ideas, pick stuff up, get critique from people I respected. I opened for Roy and Kim on one of their first shows at our first building. I opened for Jamie. I opened for Muriel Anderson, did a duet with Muriel Anderson. There's something that I will, the fear. I was a police officer.
Yeah.
Right. And I never had that fear in 20 years of police work as being on stage with Muriel Anderson going, I better not blow this. But I opened for a lot of wonderful people, did my own shows, did my CD release party, did some memorable shows of my own there where we had packed house. And I was like, wow. So I really got my feet wet doing larger audiences, solo stuff through the ACMA. And it has brought original music here. It has given a lot of traveling artists a place to come and play where you play and people listen.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody's screaming, hey, can I get a beer? Nobody's running a blender. It's quiet. The people involved are doing a wonderful job.
Well, Ray, it's great to have this opportunity to spend some time with you, get to know you a little bit, and introduce you to our audience. We will link to your website and resources so people can check you out. RayCerbone, thanks very much for keeping the music going in the middle of the state.
It's beautiful here. Thank you, Fran. Great talking to you. Great finally meeting you.
Likewise. We'll talk again soon. Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening to the Fran Snyder Podcast. please subscribe, like, or share to help your friends discover this community. Also, I'd love to hear from you with any feedback or suggestions you have. And if you'd like to learn more about house concerts and listening rooms around the world, please visit and join listeningroomnetwork.com. You can email me from there. See you next time on the Fran Snyder Podcast.